I'm Dr. Nick Delgado, and I've been teaching and educating people for over 30 years on health and lifestyle, nutrition, fitness, the power of the mind, NLP, timeline therapy, which is kind of a combination of neuro-linguistic programming and hypnosis. I'm highly trained in bioidentical hormones, and I've competed with the world's strongest strength endurance athletes in the world and usually defeat them. And at age 56, I'll be 57 in January. Steve Jobs, age 56 today, died of pancreatic cancer. I think our subject's quite appropriate. I haven't spoke on cancer for 25 years, and yet I've studied it for over 30 years. And part of the reason I didn't speak on it was because my mentor, Nathan Pritikin, once told me, he said, it's a very controversial subject. There'll be a lot of people that will have issues with suggesting that most cancers, probably 75%, are largely preventable. Some of them are quite treatable. And yet, the rate at which cancer is increasing now, if you consider that in 2008, over 13 million new cases in our country, 8 million deaths, by the year 2030, it's expected to double the number of people dying. So almost everyone you know will develop cancer and die. And I say almost because 1 in 2, that's kind of a high statistic. And I think that if you're the type of person that you want to wait until a doctor tells you you have a suspicious lump or a test that shows some kind of cancerous activity, and yet you think of a man like Steve who, I mean, he's known for the iPhone and Apple and some just amazing discoveries. I mean, you know, I've got my iPhone sitting right here, although I have a BlackBerry right next to it, but... You know, the fact is that you could be the smartest, you could be the wealthiest man in the world, and yet who knows what his lifestyle was like. I can't say for sure. I don't know exactly. He's a great speaker and educator, and unfortunately he's passed on today. We then have to recognize that no matter what access to medical care you have, it doesn't mean that you are a person that could avoid or prevent cancer. In fact, your chance of developing and dying from cancer in third world countries, such as the Bantu natives of Africa, where they give birth to an average of 9 children, they nurse each child for 2 years, they have healthy bones and teeth, they have a relatively high complex carbohydrate, low-fat diet, they rarely ever develop cancer. Many Asian cultures around the world, billions of people living on rice and vegetables and healthy food like these mushroom tacos tonight. How many here like the mushroom tacos, huh? Isn't that great? No meat, no dairy, low fat, zero cholesterol. And you might think that doesn't seem important when we're talking about the subject of cancer, when in reality it may make up 75% of the issue. And if you doubt that by the end of this talk, I think you'll be quite convinced that the evidence has been around for 30 years. And you have it within yourself to make those changes and differences. I remember I was at a conference and I spoke to one of the world experts on cancer and his research and treatment. And I was talking to him about dienylmethane and indole-3-carbinol from cruciferous vegetables. And he absolutely agreed. He said, yeah, that's a tremendous way to fight cancer, breast cancer, ovarian cancer, cervical cancer. And then I quoted another statistic and I said, do you realize that marathon runners and long distance strength endurance athletes have 1/7 the death rate from cancer as a general population? And he questioned me. He said, I've never seen that statistic. And yet I've known about that statistic for 30 years. He said, where did you get that? It's in the medical literature. It's buried in the medical literature, but doctors don't routinely prescribe high-intensity exercise where you're breathing heavily and you're getting your heart rate up and you're really, really getting that benefit from exercise. Not to the point of fatigue, because when you exercise, you should be energized by the end of your exercise session. Last night, I went down to our little fitness gym in the little basement downstairs, and on a vibration plate, while I took 30-pound dumbbells and hammer curled and pressed with loud, great music, at least I like the music, I ripped off about 300, 400, 500 lifts, got my heart rate up, had the back door open so it was nice and cool, because the evidence of good exercise benefit is not determined by how much you perspire and how hot you get. In fact, you should be exercising in cool conditions to allow your body to recover and effectively train at much higher intensity levels. So there's a lot of myths that we have about fitness and exercise and nutrition and hormones. And some people think hormones are bad for you. They actually believe that hormones somehow cause cancer. And I will go so far as to say is that synthetic hormones that are not properly monitored at dosages that are inappropriate, sure, you could have some issues with that. But the people with the highest risk factors of, say, prostate cancer have the lowest testosterone levels, the highest estrogen levels, quite the opposite of what you would believe or know, or been led to believe. So there's a number of people talking about it. There's a magazine cover, Suzanne Summers. She's written a few books, and how many cancer victims are dying needlessly. And I think you would agree that of all diseases, if you were to be told that you have a diagnosis of cancer, I would probably go so far as to believe that that would probably concern you or terrify you or create massive amount of anxiety and fear more than any other disease you could ever be told you have. Yet the interesting thing is all of you develop cancer at least several times during your life. Mutated cells occur. And hopefully your body is strong enough with a very, very strong immune system and you're putting yourself through some decent 30-minute to hour exercise sessions. You're stimulating the lymphatics. That's why I was on the vibration plate. Or you're using a mini trampoline. You're taking certain foods that are rich in beta-glucans that are arguably very potent at fighting cancerous malignant cells in your body. You're taking in cleansing, detoxifying superfoods that move toxins out of your body, unlike deoxycholic acid, which is something that's very prevalent in people who eat a very high fat, high protein, high meat diet. In the intestines, a high rate of colorectal cancer usually results. We even know that barbecued meat is the equivalent of 200 cigarettes in carcinogenic property. And yet no one's ever told you that, have they? I don't think anyone's ever shared that with you when you bit into that, you know, Labor Day weekend burger or steak and dripping down on the fat, and the fat goes into the coals, and the coals drip back the steam back into the meat, and it pyrolyzes and changes chemically and becomes a severe, serious carcinogen. So the way you cook your food, the way you consume your food, the things that you include. I was at the LA Conscious Life over the weekend, and I had a talk, and I was on a very lively panel, and I was almost every single time the dissenting opinion. And with my opinionated approach, I cited medical journals and references and doctors and educators who would support everything that I was saying. I think Dr. John Jimenez was there present at that panel. It was quite a lively panel, wasn't it? And probably by the end of the panel, people had a sense for who knew the most. It wasn't about bragging. It was just something that I pride myself on, a researcher that's dedicated to basically looking for the truth and the answers to some very serious diseases. And particularly I said this. I said cancer, arthritis, diabetes, high blood pressure, hypertension. Almost every labeled disease is simply a label. And instead of studying just the pathology of the disease and then trying to secure the drug, the chemotherapy, the radiation, the procedure that will solve cutting it out or burning it out of your body, I said, why not consider the optimum care of the body and how the body really does operate properly? And under optimum conditions, cancer is quite rare in a healthy body. And that heart disease and diabetes and high blood pressure, all and most all of these labeled diseases, or what we call chronic diseases, are rather rare or nearly impossible in a healthy body. So I can't go and tell anyone that I can cure you or this program will cure you of your diseases. In fact, I'd probably be thrown in a place with some, you know, bars and things that wouldn't be so fun to be at. And although I got a notice recently on a test that I've been doing for 30 years, looking under the microscope, looking at live blood analysis, educating people, and I think probably the most powerful test I've ever used in my life to educate people, really simply as a device to show the influx of fat into the bloodstream, how it clumps the blood cells together, the presence of candida and fungus in the blood, the presence of conditions that occur simply right after eating your typical high-fat, high-protein, high-dairy product-based American diet, and then seeing the evidence of free radical damage and showing patients that within minutes, a drop from their blood under a microscope. And yet, I can show you a piece of paper that was sent to me that says that I will owe $3,000 a day for every day that I do the test, and I will be put in jail if I continue to do that test. Even though I am certified to train medical doctors to get level 1 CME AMA credits for their continuing education credits, as a medical doctor, they can learn from me something they can't learn from any other educator in the world. But the government said, we'll throw you in jail. So I'm not here to talk about the politics, because that's not my issue. I'm here to tell you that what I've seen, what I know, on 30 years of looking at tens of thousands of people's blood and relating it to their lifestyle, to their diet, to their supplements, that I'm fairly convinced that I know the best programs. Although I can't prove it to you any longer, because there's a test that's been taken away. But maybe they'll let me do it again someday soon. Who knows? Maybe someone high up will get cancer and then they'll seek my attention and help. But as it is, if it's not high enough to be Steve, who arguably, probably in the early stages, may have had a fighting chance had he known what I know. But that's kind of a brass statement, and I want to be polite to the fact in his family that he has passed on. What was that movie? Sexy Dancing, or let's see, Dirty Dancing. Yeah. Who's the star of that? Patrick Swayze. Yeah, he died of pancreatic cancer, didn't he? Yeah. These organ cancers are pretty serious. They're pretty scary. And I sometimes wonder. Ty, I don't know what's going on with the slides. Yeah, I thought he fixed it. Okay, there you go. This man had a profound influence on my life. I was all of maybe 28 years old, and I had already graduated from USC, and I had attended professional school in physical therapy. I didn't complete those studies because I had the greatest opportunity in my life to go work with Nathan Pritikin at the Pritikin Longevity Center. In fact, within less than a year, after being diligent and tenacious and studying and working into the night and learning every lecture that he offered, he actually literally passed on his transcripts of his talks to me. The stack was about this high, and I went through all the materials, and I was one of only three doctors or educators that were permitted to do the lectures at the Pritikin Longevity Center or in the community certified by Nathan Pritikin himself, who won the Infinity Award from the American Academy of Anti-Aging Medicine, which is award that's only been given out to Linus Pauling, who, of course, you know, vitamin C and his discoveries, and Dr. Rudman, who was the discoverer of human growth hormone and its relationship to anti-aging. So what I present to you today is not simply my material. It is the material of probably more than 50 years of research around the world and documenting cultures and scientists creating a unified opinion about the origins, the causes of cancer, and the treatments. So keep in mind that although the human body is as marvelous as it is also very sensitive to changes in the environment and conditions that can alter cellular metabolism. And Nathan Pritikin himself had 14 patents in engineering and in science. He was what I would call a genius. And He routinely lectured to medical audiences and tens of thousands of people around the world. And when he was about 30 years prior to this picture, he was told he had leukemia, hairy cell leukemia. And most people don't live very long past that diagnosis. He lived a full 30 years and never told anyone he had the disease or condition. He called me up 2 weeks before he died, and he shared with me some very important things to me that I would certainly relate to and appreciate. And he said final farewells to his wife and to his son. And we didn't know why he was doing that, but he had gone into New York, Rockefeller University. There was a facility over there where they were doing interferon treatment, and it was ahead of its time, and they claimed that it would knock out his leukemia, or if it didn't work, it would knock out his kidney and liver function. Unfortunately, it didn't work. And to this day, we know that there's probably some better treatments for leukemia. But one night, instead of staying hooked up to a machine of dialysis, he decided to request a scalpel to cut out his medical journal articles. A little bit stupid, they brought him a scalpel, and he cut his arm one night and chose to take his life at the age of around late 70s, I believe. But he lived a full life, and he taught me a lot. I remember after seminars at events, he would spend hours answering questions to people. He truly had a sense of humanity and respect and care, although when he was in front of medical audiences, he was very, very, very dogged and aggressive about the wrong direction the medical profession was taking, the lack of understanding even in the hospital. So he intervened in a hospital in New Orleans where there's a very high rate of cancer and heart disease. And he was able to talk to the medical director who had gone through the Pritikin Living Center where we were training people for 30 days and we'd feed them foods like we did to you tonight. And they gained a taste for tasty, whole, natural foods. We got him interested in exercise. We got him interested in stress management. He was far ahead of his time. We were doing this 30 years ago. But he was able to convince this medical director of a hospital to completely change their approach. And simultaneously, I went to Midwood Community Hospital and Stanton Community Hospital, and I convinced the medical directors there to do the same. And I remember, literally, going into the cardiovascular units and getting the heart patients after their stroke or MI and getting the heart patients up and walking in the aisleways of the hospital and getting them over to the treadmill, walking on the treadmill and instructing the dietitians, which were using the four food groups, to please omit two of the four food groups and reevaluate how we would organize that dietary plan. And that was interesting. But because the medical director gave me the authority to make those changes, these patients got better. And in 30 days, many of them were off heart medications. They were exercising. They were returning to their home and not requiring another bypass or another series of drugs that would have clearly shortened their life. I had a gentleman come to me at the LA Conscious Life. He said he was scheduled for bypass surgery 30 years ago. And he said, my talk and the attending of my classes, which were 6 weekly classes, and in those days we charged like $250 for six weekly classes, where we prepared foods and we oriented people about lifestyle and health and nutrition and exercise. And he told me that he no longer required bypass surgery 30 years later. He's as healthy as he could ever imagine. He even showed me his lipid test. His cholesterol, triglycerides were that of a 18-year-old, that at least a healthy 18-year-old, eating healthy food. Very active, very healthy, very excited. He told me his wife no longer had glaucoma that had disappeared. And I share this story with you because one of my goals is that 30 years from now that you're healthier than you were right now. that you make some new decisions in your life to help trim down, reach your ideal weight, increase your energy, feel better, look better, make better selections about your supplements and your diet. And much like Nathan Pritikin interested me in his original book, Live Longer Now, which is down in one of my shelves here. I have fairly extensive education, medical libraries, and in these libraries, I've read every one of these books several times, underlined, outlined, circled, little notes. And now I have an Amazon Kindle, and I listen to that. I listen to at least three books every week, 300-400-page books, studying through them, updating and gaining more and more knowledge more rapidly than I ever had before. In fact, you can go to Amazon Kindle now and upload my new book, How to Stay Young, by Nick Delgado. It's the first electronic book I've ever had available. Now I can listen to my own book while I'm in an airplane and not have to deal with the stress of turning pages in a dark airplane and get motivated by my own books. Say, hey, where wrote that book? That's pretty good. That's pretty interesting stuff. I've got a new book coming out, a cookbook that'll be out soon. And if you're interested, believe it or not, here it is. Probably about 600 recipes. Haven't figured out what the title will be. But it's not sopping and greasy and oil, coconut oil and olive oil and all the fats and greases that you've all been led to believe are healthy. Because this truly will be the cookbook that is your best way to prevent cancer, heart disease, diabetes, high blood pressure, to increase your energy, to achieve your ideal body weight. It's the very same foods that I've lived on for 30 years, and I've educated clients and patients all over the world the very same. And thank you to Nathan Pritikin, because his insight and his diligence to review through tons of medical journals. In those days, we'd go down to the medical libraries down at UCLA or USC or Irvine. We'd go down into the dungeons, and we'd go down through the flights, and we'd photocopy the journals, and we'd bring them back, and I have his entire library that he passed on to me. It's here in our warehouse. And I decided to dedicate this talk to him tonight on cancer. Because this was the original talk, and you'll see some of his original slides mixed in with my new slides, because some things have updated since 30 years, but many things are very much the same as they were 30 years ago. The only difference is no one's heard this. No one's paid attention to this. Even when I did Google searches, I couldn't find information that represented what I'm going to share with you tonight. So some of you have to leave early, and I appreciate that. But maybe the care and the treatment and the possible prevention of cancer for you is a great subject and an important subject. The question that we really have to start with, what is the geography of cancer? Where do you find it? Where does it exist? And when you look around the world and you realize the incidence of cancer, where in parts of Australia they have high incidence of skin cancer, but is it really the sun? Is that really what's to blame? And yet, there's a lot of evidence that people who use sunscreens actually have as high or higher incidence of skin cancer. In fact, in primitive times they didn't use sunscreen. And the sun is quite healthy and good for you, and the fact is that vitamin D3 and vitamin D2, when the sun hits your skin, underneath the skin there's dehydrocholesterol, it converts into vitamin D3. And there's a lot of evidence that even melanoma cancer can be reduced. And the difference is, those people who eat a diet high in polyunsaturated fats, there's something about those oils that gets into the skin, and when the sun hits it, it converts and changes into abnormal forms, indeed leading to certain forms, including melanoma cancer, which is a very virulent type of skin cancer. There's evidence, too, that certain plant foods and certain substances, certain nutrients, like beets and kale, and I'll show you the list later, are so rich in nitrates, they convert into nitric oxide, and they have a profound ability to reduce the incidence of melanoma cancer. This is a product I created after 13 years of research and development. In the last 3 years, we went through prototypes. We call it Module 8. And some of you might have had a sample tonight. I think if you haven't, you should get your nitric oxide level tested. Did everyone get tested tonight yet? Okay, there you go. Was anyone depleted or low in nitric oxide? Let me see a show of hands. It's a substance that needs to be restored on a daily basis, and if not, the risk factors include the likelihood of sleep disturbances, less ideal sexual function because it vasodilates, it relaxes the arteries, which improves sexual function, less than complete physical workouts, we call it the pump, probably a higher risk of melanoma cancer. We know that low nitric oxide levels are associated with a higher rate of diabetes, heart disease, higher triglycerides. There's a number of conditions, and it's hard to imagine that a simple little pill that you suck on, releasing nitric oxide and other various important herbs, when it vasodilates, letting these herbs in, that someone, after 30 years of research, could figure out a way that could probably reduce your risk factor of certain forms of cancer. And of course, I don't stop just at the supplemental area. I suggest there's foods that accompany, but I've already told you, and I'll show you in more detail, what these foods are. I use these every day. I also believe that a lot of what I'm going to teach you is sincere and deep from my heart enough that I always believed that cancer was a really rare, strange, and confusing disease, and I probably dedicated as much or more time studying that subject. There's only one other subject I studied more than the research on cancer. And if you can figure out that other subject, you can win a bottle of something of your choice. You're right. John just won a bottle. So what do you want, John? You want Testravita? You want Amore for better sex? You choose before you leave. He's absolutely right. In fact, because of that, I'm coming out with a book on intimate function. The original title on 20 chapters I completed literally 20 years ago and never released the book because I didn't want to be typecast as someone, the sex doctor. But now it's, I guess, okay to talk about sex. But the reality is that book and its 20 chapters, I'm in the final phases of completing, and it will be releasing soon. And you'll probably find it'll be unlike any other sex book you've ever read. It will talk about how to please a woman, men how to please a man. It will talk about the various supplements that restore sexual function to that of a 22-year-old. It will talk about that sex is related to longevity, and those who have the most frequent sexual encounters per week of releasing an orgasm have half the rate of heart disease. There's all kinds of reasons why, and plus it's pleasurable. So we talk about other kinds of cancer, cervical cancer, and we talk about cancers of the colon and the prostate, and worldwide there's an epidemic of cancer, but these cancers are geographical. They do occur in higher incidences in certain areas, and they are much lower in certain areas where they eat coincidentally a high fiber, high complex carbohydrate, less animal dependent diet, almost dairy free, and it's almost true worldwide. The incidences of these diseases are amongst the lowest in the world, bar none, and the highest in the world, the closer to the Western diet that they follow. So we have to get a clue and recognize that that's probably a very important factor in this whole story and puzzle. And the reality is, when I went to Japan, where they have a rather low incidence of certain forms of cancer, but in the turn of the decade after World War, their incidence of cancer went up quite a bit because of what? What happened after the World War? Wasn't there a great American influence in and occupation of and adaption of what? U.S. Western habits, right? I even went myself and I saw most of the Japanese there prior to the Fukushima. I won't go there now. But I went there and people looked in great shape, following mostly their traditional diet, but the ones in the line for the McDonald's were clearly obese and clearly at greater risk for heart attack, stroke, and cancer. So I had a conversation today with a laboratory that tests more women on pap smears, and we had a very clear discussion because I was introduced by Mark Victor Hansen, who wrote the books series Chicken Soup for the Soul, And we had a very clear discussion about the importance of estroblock and what women who have an abnormal pap smear, or more importantly, before they have an abnormal pap smear, how they should be using this product on a daily basis, using this consistently, like Mark Rosenthal from Florida, world-renowned cancer expert in anti-aging. And he talks about the absolute essential need of the combination formula in this product that I created in 2003. I take it myself, and people say, well, why would you take estroblock? Isn't it for a woman? Absolutely. It's for a man as well, though, because men develop what? Man boobs as we get older. We lose our hair. We get enlarged prostate problems. We get bellies, and that's estrogen influence. So you want to understand why this product is so important and so important to women to reduce the incidence of breast cancer and cervical cancer and abnormal pap smears. And if it's true and possible with my influence and the people that I'm working with, potentially, if we're lucky, they will make sure that every woman who's tested, who's shown to have an abnormal pap smear, will be told about estroblock and given that option above and beyond the traditional cut, burn, and chemo and radiation. And I think that would be a good thing. So sometimes you just have to step out and be willing to take the arrows and be willing to take the risk. So tonight I'm taking that risk and sharing with you things that I've never shared with an audience before. So if you look at colorectal cancer statistics, the annual death rate by cancer type, circa 1972, you can see that the incidence of cancer compared to respiratory disease, accidents, arterial disease, cancer indeed was the number two cause of death compared to all other causes of death. If you added up lung cancer, large intestines, breast cancer, leukemia, other cancers, pancreatic cancer with Steve Jobs, and prostate cancer and stomach cancer. But worse, the annual loss of work life in man years, over 1,684,000 years due to these diseases, meaning these individuals should have lived arguably 20 more years. But what's going on in the whole area of cancer? Colorectal cancer, after the post-war, as I mentioned earlier, look at the rate in 1947, 50, 55, 60 in Japan. But look, right after the war, after about 10 years of educating them to our ways of eating and lifestyle, the rate of colon and rectal cancer in Japan is jumping up almost triple. So we must take into account the average increase on the Western diet is 579% higher incidence of cancer than in India, Uganda, and Japan, in the U.S., Scotland, and England, the Western diet. In terms of colon cancer cases, the incidence being literally 579% higher. And yet doctors aren't telling you this. And yet, most people have no clue that lymphatic system and the association of leukemia and the lymphatic system that's designed to move toxins out of your body on a daily basis due to, in part and mostly, deep breathing and exercise and sex. I'll do that in because I wanted to. I hope you're deep breathing during sex too, so I figured I'd throw it in. Look at the number one incident of death due to lymphatic cancer. New Zealand, United States, Canada, Denmark, Finland, Switzerland. What do they have in common? Sweden, Norway, Netherlands, UK. And then look at the change and consider the diets of the lowest incidence in lymphatic disease cancer. Japan, Yugoslavia, France, and Italy and Belgium. Completely different diets. Completely different, relatively speaking. And in most European cultures, when I've been to Europe, they go to a fresh fruit stand, vegetable stand. They eat their food fresh. They eat smaller portions. They're rarely ever obese, right? They exercise more than we do generally. But even in countries that are pretty active, and they seem to look in shape because they exercise enough to burn the fat off, they still have a high incidence of cancer. Again, influenced directly by beef consumption. the amount of beef consumed per capita, bovine protein consumption, grams of protein, to the direct rate of the highest rates of cancer of the lymph in the world. In fact, I remember reviewing a study of chicken being one of the major causes of lymphatic cancer. And I have a good friend, he loves to eat chicken. He says, oh, I eat low fat, all I eat is chicken. I never eat that red beef. Sure enough, he developed lymphoma cancer. And I look at that and I think to myself, this is not a smart thing in our culture to encourage fish and chicken instead of red meat, because the meat is meat. Fish and chicken has as much cholesterol as red meat. In fact, salmon has more fat and cholesterol than red meat. But none of you believe that. You've all been led to believe it's okay to eat. And you've all been led to believe that even though it has no fiber, even though it has toxins and chemicals and mercury, and it has probably hot particles now from Fukushima, that you're going to consume fish and continue to consume it after this point, and then you're making a death decision, aren't you? I think. Unless you recognize that you might as well just smoke 200 cigarettes and just puff it away. How many here smoke? Let me see a show of hands. I mean, there's closet smokers. I realize it's embarrassing to say, I smoke. Yeah, I smoke. Right? But you know it's bad to smoke. And even if you do, and they say the incidence of smoking, by the way, is still the same as it was before, it's just people are embarrassed to talk about it because people give you such a hard time about it. But if I say, let's go out for a big chicken dinner, right? Let's go have a steak tonight. Let's go have some salmon. You're going to go, oh, yeah, okay. Let's go have a cigarette. Oh, no way. Why don't you just smoke 200 cigarettes? Forget the beef. Forget the chicken and fish. Is that too extreme? I don't know. Maybe. I don't mean to be sarcastic. I'm just having fun with you because I used to eat meat, fish, chicken, turkey in gobs. Enough that I got obese. There's a picture of me when I was really fat, over 220 pounds at 5'8". And I learned what I'm telling you now. And learning this information helped me after meeting Nathan Pritikin and reading the book Live Longer Now when I was in high school and had my first TIA or stroke. And then I learned through diet and exercise to get in shape. So my goal is always to stay in shape and always be fit and to be in that lifestyle or healthy habit, so that when you see I was holding in my stomach for this picture and I couldn't hold it in, and here I was holding it in, you say, oh, he's holding in his stomach. Well, I was holding it in there too and I couldn't hold it in. I was too fat. You can see how fat I was in the face. I think I actually looked older at age 23 in that picture than I do today. But you look at the correlation between diet and breast cancer. Total fat was the strongest correlation, the highest correlation to breast cancer of any other factor. Second was fat with meat. Third was animal protein itself. Then animal fat and meat and eggs, very high in the list. Total protein, sugar at the bottom. Sugar was less correlated to cancer than all these other factors. Not that I'm saying you should run out and eat a bunch of sugar, yet you know it's not appropriate to eat a lot of sugar. But you seem to think it's okay to eat eggs every day, or chicken or fish or turkey and meat. And I know it sounds extreme, and you might think, oh, I'm not going to go for that vegetarian stuff. I tried it before and I got weak. Well, the reason you got weak, you didn't know. You were eating a bunch of carrots and you thought that's a vegetarian, and you can't get enough calories from carrots and celery and tomatoes. You have to eat food substance. You have to eat something with yams and potatoes, like the cultures around the world, Peruvian diet, the Vietnamese diet, the Asian diet, the Latino diet. There are diets that are beautifully represented, and when you get my cookbook, you're going to find out there's amazing tasting foods that don't have to have a bunch of grease and protein and fat concentrations. So, can the food you eat cause cancer? I think it's undeniable. Would an occasional consumption of those foods cause cancer? Unlikely. It's the repetitive use, the belief that that plate of salmon every night is better for you than a plate of potatoes, rice, and corn, and fruits and vegetables. Truly. It really is that simple. You might be able to cut your risk of cancer arguably by 80 to 90% just by making that one big shift in your thinking and belief. Believe it or not. Can't change. Don't know why. Okay. So, in cancer, December, listen how far back, 1969. Dr. Ernest Winder, a famous cancer researcher, which I met in person, I know him, met him very, very clearly, and he stated this. One can plot the incidence of breast cancer against any number of environmental factors. The one correlation that shows up well and may be of etiological significance is between breast cancer and the fat intake of women in various countries of the world. That's, I think, a very, very profound and important statement. It's a very important statement. Important enough that when they went and did, they took mice, and they were able to induce mammary tumors in a control group of eating basically whatever mice eat. They gave them an egg white diet. There was no incidence of mammary tumors. The lifespan was basically shortened, though, on the high-protein diet. Notice that egg yolk in the diet shortened more so, 33% incidence of mammary tumors, and in the cholesterol and lard group. And remember, cholesterol is only in anything that has legs, wings, could wiggle, or could move. It's in fish, it's in chicken, it's in turkey. 574 lifespan, 51 shortening of lifespan, that is 51% incidence of mammary tumor. Okay, so when you compare then the longevity of and the mammary tumors, what we have to first take into account is that a mouse is somewhat of a carnivore. They are designed to eat meat and proteins, and you were not designed. You're omnivore. You can eat a little bit of meat, a little bit of fish, a little chicken, not to the extent that you do to these days. So when we consider that cancer, and we look at oxygen exposure and the immune enhancers, and we realize that the Adventists, in our culture, Adventists, Seventh-day Adventists, have 35% less breast cancer than meat eaters, according to the study by Phillips. So what does the diet, and what does fat, and what does meat have to do with breast cancer? And you have to realize that this breast cancer problem, that the tumor, the incidence of, that is the survival rate in those women who are diagnosed with cancer. If you take a look, and we hear now that our traditional current treatment of chemotherapy and radiation, removing the breast, in fact, some women are electing for pre-removal of the breast tissue when they don't even have breast cancer. Literally, they're going in for surgery because a mom or a sister has breast cancer. And yet, you think about it, and you ponder about it, and you look up in the journals, and what you're told is that the survival rate is better. But I would argue the detection rate is better. Meaning the equipment, the sensitivity of equipment, will detect that breast cancer far before it even shows up as a lump. The size of a pea, it's already been in your breast 20 years. And you don't even know it's there. But if we detect it earlier, then you go on to chemotherapy and radiation, they say, see, you live 20 years longer. Not. Does any woman ever really die of breast cancer? Does the breast tissue kill them? Never. It metastasizes, and these cells end up going to target organs, spleen, brain, liver, and they say, oops, she didn't die of breast cancer, but I don't know, we removed her breasts, we did chemotherapy, she lost her hair, she got sick, you know, wiped out her immune system, but I don't understand, she died of pancreatic cancer, she died of liver cancer, brain cancer. She died of her lifestyle and no one told her. And no one told her how to build up her immune system. No one shared with her the importance of daily exercise and oxygenating the body and the lymphatics and eating these whole natural foods. No one did. They just said, here, take these drugs, these chemotherapy drugs, let's do the surgery and you're cured. I personally think that's a disservice to women. Because you've misled them. You've abused them, you've harmed them, and you haven't solved the original problem. And you collected about $400,000 in their insurance money. Maybe it's only $100,000. I could be off. So something's wrong with our system right now, right? We know we can detect, we don't die of breast cancer, we die of brain cancer. We die in some other target organ. And we know that when Dr. Goldblatt did his early studies, And what they did was they took the same cells from a cardiac tissue and they put them into three different test tubes, and they made sure that there was nitrogen and not enough oxygen. They pushed out all the oxygen. Nitrogen can exist, the cells can exist, and most of the cells died, but some of the cells mutated because there wasn't enough oxygen to supply them or nutrients. When they mutated, they turned into forms of cancer. They then took those cells, injected them into animals, and every one of the animals developed cancer and died. They then repeated the experiment during the same period with the same cells in another test tube. They gave them aerobic, in other words, full oxygen, the correct ratio that the body, when you breathe heavily during exercise, the correct nutrients, no restriction from olive oil that clumps the blood cells and restricts 20% of your entire circulation of blood flow getting to the micronutrients and the tissues of the cells of the body, to the brain, to the heart, to the organs. No malignancy whatsoever. They injected the cells in animals, no cancer. I don't know what more conclusive evidence you need to understand that he was awarded the Nobel Prize for this discovery, and yet no one talks about it. Pritikin did. I do. John McDougall does. Neil Bernard does. There's a handful of doctors, and I'm sure the top treatment centers in the future will, because when you realize that most of us are concerned about carcinogenicity and that certain chemicals undeniably can cause a mutated cell, certainly we see that salt and penicillin cause zero incidence of carcinogenicity. I mean, salt, you can salt your food all day long. You're never going to get cancer from salt. It's a nutrient you need. And we've been led to believe that salt's so bad for us. Salt holds fluids and tissues in our body. Every culture in the world esteems salt. Salute! He wasn't worth his salt. His weight in salt. He wasn't worth his weight in salt. Every culture has a word for salt. To cross the deserts, they had to have salt to hold fluids in their tissues. There's companies now coming out with nutrients that provide a mixture similar to salt and sea salt. And what is trace minerals? It's salt and trace minerals and nutrients. So I don't restrict salt intake when people are exercising, eating healthy, whole natural foods. I don't want you to be getting a lot of packaged foods loaded with sodium, but I do believe that whole natural fresh food with a little bit of natural present salt or sea salt is appropriate. Now, you look at cigarette smoke and it's 18,000 relative carcinogenicity, and you look at aflatoxin, which is found in like peanuts and things that are grown under the ground, and sometimes they get this kind of mold. It's called aflatoxin. It's highly carcinogenic. So you have to be careful. You have to understand that you're better off with almonds and cashews and walnuts and things that grow above ground and that can easily be preserved and protected free of aflatoxins. Barbecuing, I mentioned earlier, is like 200 cigarettes in carcinogenic property. Benzopyrene, 4-5 oxidized. So tumors in rats and diet of those consuming smoke foods was 17% higher compared to the rat chow. We know that the Japanese eat a lot of fish, and the fish tends to change with nitrosamines, and that issue versus the raw fish seems to be a problem, especially potentiated with its cholesterol content. And here was the biggest surprise. It wasn't a surprise to see that the incidence in men and women of cigarette smokers did have a fairly high rate of lung cancer. Something about the cigarette obviously triggered the initial tissue in the lungs to mutate and change and become cancerous. What we didn't expect, first off, was that chest X-ray, those who were detected 5 years early compared to those without X-ray, the survival rate was no different. So that goes back to the comment that early detection does not prove you're going to cure that cancer with chemotherapy, radiation, and traditional treatments. Early detection, new cases detected, 121 cases, 120,000 x-rays in 10 years, $600,000 cost per detection, $5,000, and yet no difference in survival rate. So when you look at the Ames carcinogen screening test, normal bacteria, mutant bacteria, changes in certain bacteria mutations, there's a positive correlation with chemicals and carcinogenity. So yeah, there is something wrong with cigarettes. But how do you answer the Asian paradox where they smoke so much and they have a lower incidence of lung cancer than we do? Until Dr. Jeremiah Stamler in Chicago was measuring individuals who were cigarette smokers or not, and he was shocked to find that those with the highest cholesterol levels had the highest incidence of lung cancer. And yet we go to events and we test cholesterol people's cholesterol levels. They say, oh, my doctor checked it. He said it was normal. I would be concerned if your doctor told you your cholesterol is normal, because normal is the Western normal level, and it puts you at a very high risk of various forms of heart attack, stroke, and cancer now. And what was it about it? I'll answer that in a little bit. But we looked at the smokers, the urine carcinogenity, non-smokers versus mutagenicity in the urine, and the Ames test showed clearly that smokers do have a relatively high concentration showing up in their urine as well. Hold on a second. So in Science magazine, they went so far as to say for prevention of cancer, chemicals in the workplace, in the environment, and in the diet may be the single most important cause of human cancers. They knew this in 1974. And they knew that asbestos and cancer deaths, that you look at total deaths and cancer of all sites, notice that lung cancer and then mesothelioma, which is a very rare form of cancer, and those asbestos workers, where they're working with insulation, these workers in the U.S. and Canada, they had this rare form of cancer exposed to asbestos. So clearly asbestos, stomach cancer, rare form of mesothelioma cancer, and certain forms of lung exposure. So aflatoxin is a powerful carcinogen. It's excreted by a fungus called Aspergillus flavus, and it often grows in peanuts. So I would not go about eating a lot of peanuts if I were you. So cholesterol and tumor growth. Notice, a diet with cholesterol compared to cholesterol-free, fat-free diet. The incidence of various forms of identified cancers dropping from 40 to 50%, even though the cancer tumor was present, meaning that if you chose to go and you have a tumor in your body right now that you don't know about, and you chose to bring your cholesterol down naturally through eating mushroom tacos instead of carnitas tacos, you start eating rice and beans, fruits and vegetables, and whole natural food, rich in the nitrites, the plants, the greens, and you exercise, all these things prove that tumors do shrink. And yet your only weapon that you're told that can protect you from cancer is what two primary treatments? The only two treatments that doctors always bring out. What is it? Chemo and radiation. Let's add the third. It's surgery. Surgically remove it. Hold on. So in Canada, they took a 70-year-old, a 65, 70-year-old. They did needle biopsy, proved they had prostate cancer. They put them on cholestyramine in a low cholesterol diet, and no cancer was present after 3 years. After 3 years, the prostate normal. After 1 month, the prostate normal. So we know that a combination of estroblock, removing the harmful estrogens, and what does diet have to do with fat and estrogen? Well, a high-fat diet converts in the intestines to estrogen, a harmful form of estrogen. So we know that estroblock helps to clear this out. We know that using the Slim Blend, using this product, has its naturally high incidence of fiber that attracts the carcinogens and helps to reduce the harmful estrogens and balances the body out. So every day we do a blended drink of this. We know that Claro specifically lowers cholesterol, a proven carcinogen. And it's not a carcinogen. Let me correct myself. Your body makes cholesterol. Every cell of your body makes cholesterol. The liver makes the most. And if you never ate cholesterol in your entire lifetime, you'd maintain a cholesterol of about 100 to 150. But the average American cholesterol is over 200. Why is it over 200? Because you persist in eating fish, chicken, and turkey, thinking that's safer than red meat. And you eat eggs, and you eat cheese, and all the things that keep the cholesterol up. And yet, if you just make a correction in your diet and eat only foods that have roots, and grew, anything that has roots and grew has no cholesterol on it. If it has high fiber, it draws cholesterol out of the system in the form of bile, it pulls it out. And then you take this product called Claro, and it targets LDL, the harmful form of cholesterol, with 12 ingredients that I've been able to prove specifically help to lower and modulate cholesterol production, the liver and other factors, along with polycosinol, which helps to build up lean body mass. And there's an ingredient there that helps to target candida in the blood. So estroblock might be one of your best ways to fight breast cancer, prostate cancer. And DIM does not limit estrogen activity in the brain, so it's even safe for women. And if a woman's on the pill, it helps to remove the harmful metabolites. The estroblock has been shown in the literature to be 5 times more potent than anything on the market. Now, I can tell you this. You could eat a lot of raw vegetables. You could eat a lot of raw broccoli, Napa cabbage, bok choy, as I do. I put it in a blender. You'd have to eat about 2 to 5 pounds of raw cruciferous vegetables a day to equal 2 tablets of estroblock. So I take 4 tablets of estroblock every day. Morning and night, 2 and 2. And I eat a healthy diet because I want to join the 120 plus club. I want you to live the longest possible free of cancer. And the biggest risk to your longevity is cancer, heart disease, and diabetes. So if you do this, and keep it in mind that your oncologist is not going to solve the problem. Here's the conspiracy. Cigarette smoke may trigger it, but it doesn't cause the endpoint death or the tumor to grow out of control. There's something about cholesterol that inhibits the immune system, and that's why we discovered those people with the cholesterol over 200 on a heavily meat-laden diet tend to die from lung cancer if they're a cigarette smoker. It took both. And some people get lung cancer with never having smoked their entire lifetime, and that's perplexing to people. That pisses them off. He never smoked, and yet he died of lung cancer? Look at what he ate. It's very clear. Look at what he ate. And we look at the common foods that are hidden with cholesterol. And at our break, we're going to talk about these things for a moment. I'm going to take a break right now. But I'm going to end at this break with one comment that I made very clear at the LA Conscious Life over this weekend. There was a study in Dr. Contreras, a renowned oncologist who I respect. He stated this. He said there was a review of the medical literature, and the oncologists were asked, if your patient came to you with a form of cancer that you felt could be treated by chemotherapy or radiation, would you treat that patient with chemotherapy or radiation? 100% of the oncologists who are experts in cancer treatment said what? Yes, absolutely. And then they asked the next question. If you, doctor, develop cancer, or your wife or your children or significant other develop cancer, would you treat them with chemotherapy or radiation? Do you know what the answer was in the oncology journals? 100% said no. So I don't know if it's profit-driven, but I do tell you that chemotherapy drugs do make per patient the hospital and the pharmaceutical companies somewhere in excess of $40,000 to $100,000 per patient. So we have a problem in our culture now owning up to the reality of what the origin of disease is and how to treat it. But since you know the truth now, you know the truth. What you do with that truth is up to you. So we're going to take a break right now, and I'm going to snatch a few mushroom tacos, and we'll come back, and I know I'm going to introduce our next speaker, and then we're going to come back.